to worship, everyone. We are Peterborough United Methodist Church. I am Pastor Lori Savick, and I'm so glad that we made it here today, safely through the rain, through the jelly, all the things that were getting in our way this morning. We have found our way to this place. This week, as I'm sure many of you know, an atrocity occurred at an African Methodist Episcopal Church in South Carolina. What happened at Emmanuel Church when I heard of it made me wonder, have we come any farther in all of these years than we have been talking about race relationships in our country? Right? I worry about where we are as a nation. But when we gather in this place of worship, we are gathering in faith, in a different kind of story, a story of hope, a story of resurrection, a story of constancy and covenant through everything. There's a typo in your bulletin of the choir next to Gathering Song. The choir is done for the season. I would like us to sing the Gathering Song together, and in mindfulness of where we are as a nation, I invite us to sing, "We Shall Overcome," as an anthem of hope. It's number 533 in your bulletin. When you find the number, I invite you to sing.
We shall overcome.
large print hymnal or Bible there in the front row. And I invite Dr. Phyllis Porter, our liturgist this morning, to come forward and lead us in the announcements of the Lord's Prayer.
Nobody handed me any announcements. Does anyone have an announcement they'd like to make from church? Yes.
In preparation of Vacation Bible School, we're required to do background checks on all our volunteers. So this morning, if you filled out one of these papers, I'm going to be set up in the fellowship hall to notarize your signature. So please stop by and see me. I have the papers.
Linda.
Today, we're off with a little shaky start with our ice cream social and the sauces that we brought in. So we're inviting you all after to please join us for an ice cream social. And if you'd like to make donations, it does go to World's Children. Our sponsor child, we sponsor like a $330 sponsorship a year. So we're looking for some funds for that. Also, the scholarship program for a child that is not necessarily in child fund, but in the area that could use some support going to school. So I'll be out there, and to let you know, imagine no malaria. You know, we've been doing a lot of work. We're within $40 of our goal. So thank you all so much.
Thank you, Linda, for everything you do. Jim?
I'm going to try to make this as short as possible, but this week I was honored to be one of your representatives to the New England Annual Conference, and it was an inspiring conference. We had incredible discussions on what our country has done to our Native American population and what we can do about it. We had a wonderful presentation on Friday night when we had a commissioning service and ordination service, and we were fortunate enough to have our pastor, Doris Savitt, obtain a commission on her pathway to ordination. And I am so pleased that she was honored with that great ceremony. It was a moving ceremony. Over 3 hours we sat through an incredible presentation. One speaker, Reverend Gregory Palmer, is one of the finest spokespersons for the Methodist Church I've ever seen, and a brilliant speaker. And he made a wonderful homily. And I'd like to give Pastor Roy just a symbol of what it takes in our love for her and the presentation I hope she will wear with pride in the future. Thank you so much.
To remember membership in the annual conference and to ordain ministry, to be set apart as clergy. And I will be receiving for the next few years the support of those people who have already made to that point and their mentorship and guidance as I prepare for their responsibility. The liturgical stole is a symbol of ordination. This is a symbol that one is a minister wherever one goes, that one's life has been transformed for this ministry. So this gift you have given me is a gift that you recognize this call in me, and that I am a minister beyond this local church and community. And I thank you so much for that blessing.
Thank you.
Listen to a 3-hour service, you should move directly to ordination. Do not pass go. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Together, please, in the opening prayer. Oh God,
in the ministry of our lives, you are present in our lives, bringing your life out of destruction, hope out of despair, growth out of difficulty. We thank you that you do not leave us alone, but labor to make us whole. Help us to perceive your unseen hand within the holding of our lives, and to attend the gentle guidance of your spirit, that we may know
time of our worship service, as the younger members of our congregation are leaving for Sunday school, when we have taken a moment to witness where God's grace is active in our lives, is also a time when we have witnessed to those places where we need prayer, where we need the companionship of Christ. What a wonderful salvation it is when we always see Christ's face. This week is a complicated week. It is just another week in a series of weeks of growing concern about where our country is going, how we are living as Christians with one another, how we are transforming the world in love. I think on a dim, slightly rainy day, it's important to take this time and use it just a little bit differently. I would like to invite specific testimonies about where you need prayer in the context of what is going on in our country, and what grace has helped you in receiving news about the situation like in South Carolina. Does anyone have a testimony to that they can share?
This does not reflect this week's tragedies, singular or multiple, as in South Carolina. But I believe that if we look and we open, we will see a sign of love from God, that He is with us in all things. And I say that because of an experience that happened to me after 9/11. I have always loved the story of the rainbow and God's coming to us. And we came down from the North Country to visit my mother the Friday of that week of 9/11. And along with everyone else, we were in grief and shock. And we sat that Friday in front of the TV and watched the ceremonies and were shaken. But I walked out into my mother's living room, and she lived in a house that was on a curve. And it was a beautiful, bright, sunny day. And I looked up at the end of the street, and there was a beautiful rainbow. There was no reason chemically, geographically, naturally that rainbow should exist. But it did. And I took it as a sign of God's renewal and God's love. And I kind of felt it was just for me. So if we look, God will send us a sign.
As someone who grew up in the South and experienced firsthand the evil of segregation and the philosophy that it followed, and fought it at every time I had a chance to, I was somewhat inspired by the service held in Charleston when I saw the white and the black communities come together in mourning. That would never happen when I was a kid. And that, to me, is a wonderful thing. And we can all take some solace in the fact that the community was coming together. And that's what we need. Share God's love with each other and help each other, regardless of what the circumstances are.
Michelle?
Well, this is, I know all of you know the story of Josh, and things are happening in the court system, and I'll try to make this short, but they had a meeting with the family, and they're getting ready for the sentencing hearings, and it's horrible, the things that happened to Josh when he was asked to speak, and recommend what he felt the sentencing should be, because it'd be 20 years to life. He told them, he says, well, one of the boys has a child, and he said, I would like him to have a short sentence because I want him to be able to see his child grow up. So, shows the compassion he had for horribly what happened to him.
Thank you, Sean. I read a recommendation that was online in a ministry gathering, a place where pastors and other people who are involved in ministry can send information and recommendations to one another. And through that source, I was given some information from a black clergyman about what would be most helpful, what can we do in our churches to help, to be a sign of grace like the ones that you have witnessed to today. And one of the things that he said was most important was that not only black flat pastors and black churches speak out against what happened. I'm so glad that we have had this time to witness to one another. This is important. This is why we are here. And as I am your pastor and you have acknowledge my authority in that role, let me say that this violence is against God. This violence is against love. This is not who we are called to be. This could have happened in this church. It has not, and it is not happening in this church because we are privileged. When we gather here on a Sunday morning and presume our safety, when we come for classes, that is a privilege, right? And it is important that we stand together with all of our brothers and sisters in Christ, wherever they are in the world, to say that hate crimes, this kind of violence, is not what God wants for us. We pray that God will make us one. One with each other, one in God. We will share each other's burdens. We will share each other's tragedies. Thank you for allowing me to say that. Let us pray, God. We pray to you this morning, Savior, living, risen Christ. Our hearts are full of all of creation's complexities. This morning we witness to hope. We witness to forgiveness. We witness to grace. We witness to your presence with us. Our confidence in your covenant. And we do this because we believe in your story. We believe that you are alive. We believe that you have conquered death. We believe that you set prisoners free, that you proclaim good news to the poor, that you can turn those things that are burdens to us into beautiful gifts. You have the power of transformation. Holy God, we lift our hearts to you today, hoping in you and needing you to sanctify us and make us strong in your love. Make us the witnesses you call us to be. Remove from us those prejudices and hatreds that cut us off from one another. Make your sign of presence with us be love flowing from our hearts. Lord, we lift all of our prayers to you. Prayers for the ones that we love. Prayers for the ones that we do not know. Prayers for the ones that you have called us to acknowledge as brothers and sisters, wherever they may be, because you have lovingly created them in your image. We lift them in the silence of our hearts with courage and conviction that you know them and hear them, and also with the words that we speak aloud. Holy God, this is the day that our culture recognizes as Father's Day. As we are here today in the presence of you, our Maker, our Parent, we give you thanks for all the ways that our forefathers have provided for the practice of our faith, the traditions that govern our society, for those good and just things that are present here as reflections of you. We give you thanks for the ways in which our fathers here on earth have followed your example, have shown us your kind of love, have raised us in those virtues that you bestow, those gifts. Lord, we lift up those wounds that are caused by all parents who do not respect your care for their children, who have harmed us. And we give you thanks that you have the power to overcome, to bear us up, to heal all wounds, to turn our mourning into dancing. And so we pray to you, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Scripture this morning is from Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. And the chapter reminds us of the storms of life. We have heard much of that this week, with violence individually and collectively, with violence of nature in the floods in the south and the fires in Alaska. So let us remember God's promise. With this story, when Jesus calms the storm. That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was, in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of the scripture.
Let us sing together in response to the scripture, "Be Still My Soul," number 534 in your blue hymnal.
Please stand as you're able.
Reagan. Lord, may these words of my mouth and the meditation and witnesses, grief and hope in our hearts, be precious in your sight. For you are our rock, our strength, and our redeemer. Amen. Because of the commitments of annual conference this week, I planned this service in advance. This text that Phyllis read for you today was the lectionary text for this week. I chose these hymns before what happened. God works in mysterious ways. I know for me, this time together is my rainbow. The hymn we sang concludes with the verse, "Be still, my soul. The hour is hastening on when we shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, love's purest joys restored. Be still, my soul. When change and tears are past, all safe and blessed, we shall meet at last." This verse is not about death. It is not about heaven. We serve a risen Savior. This verse is about sanctification. That is our belief that even as we are worshiping God and following in the ways of Christ and living as disciples and apostles, we are approaching that hour when we shall be with God, one with God. When disappointment, grief, and fear will be gone, sorrow forgot, and love's purest joys restored. I think in our common life, we often experience joy as a surprise. It is not our typical attitude. It comes when we forget to be worried about stuff. When we have a blessed moment that breaks through all of the common cares and mundanities that kind of ground down our spirit and our presence and our attention. It comes when, for whatever reason, something calls us to be fully present. Our attention gathered back from all the places where it has been diffused into a moment in which we can experience that ecstasy and joy. Joy is not result of ignorance or innocence or being apart from the trials of life. Joy is not naive. Joy is the gift of a God who makes covenant, a God who is risen, a God whose life story among us as Jesus Christ is a story about how nothing, no matter how dark, no matter how seemingly final, no matter how temporal or scientific or seemingly appropriate in our own ways of understanding, right? No matter how much death seems to be in control, no matter how powerful hate may seem to be, that is not the story. That is not the story. Because Christ is risen. What it means to be Christian is that we claim joy. We stand building our hope on the love of God. And our very life together is the witness that that is a strong and sure foundation. Jesus is in a boat. He's crossing the Sea of Galilee. His disciples are with him. And the waves come up. And they are afraid. They wake Jesus up, and Jesus calms the storm, and he confronts them on their faith. And they are still afraid. In this gospel story, we do not hear that the disciples relaxed and rejoiced after Jesus did what he did. They are still afraid. Now, some commentaries say that the way we should understand the fear of the disciples in this moment is that fear that is mixed with awe before the power of God, and undoubtedly that was present too. But it's important for us also to acknowledge that Christians experience sorrow, right? We confront pain. We live through grief. That does not make us faithless. It does not make us faulty. That is our world. Grief is the cost of loving and losing, right? And Jesus even had that experience for himself. Jesus experienced pain. Jesus experienced loss. Jesus wept. There is a big difference between the comfort of hearing there is nothing to be afraid of and the comfort of hearing do not be afraid. Which one does the gospel give us? Which one does the gospel give us? In one of the commentaries that I read in preparation for this message, a commentary written by Michael Lindvall, he brings up that image of the child who has a nightmare and whose parent comes and gathers them into their arms. And what is it, the tendency of the parent to say? It was just a dream. There's nothing to be afraid of. And Michael Lindvall says, it is important to note, and I'm quoting here, that Jesus never says there is nothing to be afraid of. He goes on to say, although we often confuse them, saying there's nothing to be afraid of is a very different thing from saying do not be afraid. The hard truth is that fearsome things are very real. Isolation, pain, illness, meaninglessness, rejection, losing one's job, money problems, failure, illness, humiliation, death. As we grow in faith, we come to understand that even though such fearsome things are very real, they do not have the last word. They do not have ultimate power over us. Because reigning over this world of fearsome things is a God who is mightier than they. Time and again in Scripture, the word is, do not be afraid. It is, you might say, the first and the last word of the gospel. It is the word the angels speak to the terrified shepherds, and the word spoken at the tomb when the women discover it is empty. Do not be afraid. Not because there are no fearsome things on the sea of our days. Not because there are no storms, fierce winds, or waves. Not because there is no hatred and violence. But rather because God is with us. And God is bigger. I added that last part myself. Do you agree with me? Amen? One of my favorite songs to sing to myself when I'm feeling low or when I'm feeling very, very high is His Eye is on the Sparrow. Does anybody know that song?
We do
know that song. Good, good. And the chorus of that song, this is why I like to sing this song. The chorus of that song is almost like a creed, right? A weird kind of creed because it doesn't have any fancy terminology in it. It doesn't recap the story of Jesus. But I think it speaks the truth about the hope that is not naive. right? The joy that comes as a gift from God amidst our pain. I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free. God's eye is on the sparrow, and God's watching over me. Can we sing that chorus together? I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow. He's watching over me. I sang a little differently than you know. His eye is on the sparrow. I'm happy and free, not because I just feel happy and free. I'm happy and free not because I made myself that way. I'm happy and free not because of the choices that I made in my life or because the way the culture permits me to be. I'm happy and free because the gospel of grace has shown me a different ending to this story. An ending that does not stay in the tomb, but is too big for that. Right? I'm happy and free because our God is a God that cares about birds that you can buy 2 for a penny. And how much more must our God care about us, made in God's own image? I thank you so much for being here and sharing your witness this morning, for resting in this space. It's a difficult place to be. I thank you for sharing your tears. I thank you for sharing your testimonies and for bringing your hearts into worship today. We are going to have an offering. And in our offering, we are saying, thank you, God. Thank you, God, for carrying us even before we knew you were here. For caring about us. And in our offering, we give our gifts of our very selves. We give our prayers. We give our presence. We give our witness. Let us give thanks to God.
Where would we be if your love and care were not headed upon the sea?
sing together hymn number 534, Eastern High School. I knew that was wrong. 377, It Is Well With My Soul.
Acknowledging the collective sin of our world. the grief of loss, acknowledging injustice. Even so, let it be well with your soul. This hymn was written by a father whose wife and children were lost to a storm. Even so, let it be well. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.